So our men, our scripture for today, it comes to us from the 18th chapter of Matthew's Gospel. And I thought about a story that I heard some while back and did some digging around and found it again. And maybe you've heard the story about the church where the pastor and the choir director was at odds with one another. They just wasn't getting along. Very well, and as time went by, it began to spill over into the congregation, which is not a good thing at all. Well, I come to find out first week preacher gets up and he preaches on commitment and how we should all dedicate ourselves to the service of God. And as soon as he finished, the choir director got up and led the congregation in the hymn, "I Shall Not Be Moved." And so the second week, the preacher got up and he preached on tithing and how we should gladly give our all to the work of the Lord. And then following the sermon, the choir director got up and led the congregation in the hymn, "Jesus Paid It All." So the third week, the pastor got up and he preached about gossiping and how we shouldn't gossip and how we should need to be watching our tongues and what we say. And choir director got up right after that and led the congregation, "I love to tell the story." And so this went on and on and on, and finally the pastor goes, "You know, I think it's just time for me to leave that church." He said, you know, he told the congregation that particular Sunday, he said, "You know, I'm thinking about resigning." And then he sits down and the choir director gets up. He said, "Well, let's just sing the hymn, Why Not Tonight?" Well, so it came to pass as the pastor said, I'm going to do it. He announced to the congregation. He said, "You know, I'm going to retire or I'm going to resign, and this is going to be my final worship service." You know, it was Jesus that brought me into this church, and it's Jesus that's taking me away from the church. And he sat down, and the choir director got up. He said, "Well, let's just sing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus." it just wasn't a good thing, but you know, that's a humorous story, but there's a lot of, and it's not very realistic, but it does talk about a little bit about church conflict how church conflict affects the whole congregation. It can ruin churches and creates a dissension in entire communities. So let me begin this morning by saying that I'm not preaching this because we have some church conflict that I need to address this morning. I've been following the lectionary text, and this is the suggestion for today in our lectionary text that was written about 3 years ago. So I'm just following along with the preaching schedule that I'm doing. In fact, I really believe that we are truly blessed as a congregation, and our unity in this congregation is truly blessed, because I've seen churches or maybe even been in churches where that has not always been the case, and it does. It causes a lot of stress, and so Matthew seems that it is important for us, or for the early church, his early church in the first century, to hear Jesus' words about church conflict, church discipline, because we know, I know that Christians. Some Christians can be some of the meanest people that we'll ever meet. And it's just not that is today, but it was in Jesus' day as well. And so our text is from the 18th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, beginning with the verse 15. And it's Jesus' teaching on how to respond to church members when we're in conflict with them. Hear the word of the Lord. "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So you know by now that from our prayer time and my time here with you that as church members, we are the body of Christ. We are the church, the body of Christ, the hands and feet of Jesus in the here and now. And so we know that if you speak of the body, that it's not healthy for the body to be in conflict within. We have our prayer list that we went over this morning that had some people in that kind of shape. A conflict in the body is not a good thing, whether that be a cancer or a virus or infection of some type. The body just can't function the way God intended the body to function when there's something going on the inside, an infection, if you will, a cancer. And so you know, if we go to the doctor because we have something going on in us, that they run the test, they find out where the infection is, what it is, if it's a cancer or what or the such, and they try to cure it, and they try to get it to go into remission. And if they can't, the only way to save the body, if you will, is to remove the cancer, right? Remove the cancer. Well, Matthew is saying that is the case when he compiles Jesus' teachings in this 18th chapter of his gospel. In order for the body of Christ, the church, to be healthy, there may be times when we need to remove the cancer, if you will. As we think of this, I don't want your mind to start making a mental list of all the cancers that we need to eliminate in our church today. Not specifically our local church, maybe the church as a whole, or we could do that. Don't let your minds go there. Think about this, where we are here. Because what Matthew has done in our text in this 18th chapter, he has this part sandwiched in between two other parts. So prior to our text this morning, we have the parable of the lost sheep in verses 12 through 14. And in that parable, it's about how God values each person. Everyone just is like they were the only person on earth. Each person has value. And in that parable, Jesus, being the good shepherd, would leave the 99 and go look for that one lost stray. And then on the other side of our text this morning, in verses 21 and 22, we have the story of Peter asking Jesus how many times he must forgive someone who offends him. As many as seven times, he says, and you know the answer. Jesus says, no, not seven times, but 77 times, or seven times 70, depending on which gospel you read that particular story. And so we have this text about church discipline in the middle of these two texts about love and about forgiveness. And we must keep that in mind as we exegete the text, if you will, as we pick it apart and try to understand what Jesus is trying to tell us. So in verse 15, if you brought your Bible to church or your Bible app, in verse 15, if another member of the church sins against you, what do? Well, in the original Greek, the Greek manuscript actually says that if your brother sins against you, indicating that as church members, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are a family. We are a family. That's why we get at odds at one another sometimes, because close families do that. It's just a natural thing. So Jesus says, this is how you handle a church family member who sins against you. He says, you go to that person in private, so they won't be embarrassed, and you point out the person's wrong. And you say something like, you know, what you are doing or what you have posted on Facebook or what you are saying is not compatible with Christian teaching. And so by doing that, you've accomplished several things. You're letting them know that you care about them, because when you went to that person, you did it in such a loving way that your love just spilled over. And you let them know that what they were doing or what they were saying or what they were posting has been noticed. And then you put the ball in their court for them to respond. Now, the Bible says in verse 15 here that if they respond positively, then you have won, regained that member, is what they say. In other words, it's like verse 13 prior. But you've gone out and like the good shepherd, and you brought back the lost sheep, the lost stray one, and they're rejoicing. But the matter of fact is, you know as well as I do, that people don't respond very well when they're told they're in the wrong. And that's why Paul tells us in Galatians 6:1 that if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit, listen to that now, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. That means that we have to confront them in such a loving way that they are actually built up and encouraged by you coming in and doing that, about someone caring about them enough to make things right. Verse 16, Jesus says that if they don't listen to you, then take a couple of mutual friends with you who have noticed the wrong taking place, but also a couple of people who love them as well, who love them enough to want to see that they are helped and restored. Now these two requirements, these two witnesses, if you will, they go all the way back from the Old Testament and the Torah law from Deuteronomy 19. The Torah law says a single witness shall not prevail against a person for any crime or wrongdoing in connection with any offense that may be committed. Only on the evidence of two or three witnesses shall a charge be sustained. And so you're to take two witnesses with you, two loving witnesses, if you will. You're not trying to be at odds with them. Remember the mindset and the heart set is to restore. So in verse 17, if the offender refuses to even listen to them, Jesus says to take it before the leaders of the church. It says the church here in the text, but it really means the leaders of the church, or if you come from a background that has deacons of the church, you can say that, or the PPR committee, if you will, take it to the leaders of the church. Now remember, this is an offense against a single person, and we're not told what that offense is, but it's a serious enough offense that the person's soul is at stake. Possibly the reputation of the church is at stake as well, of which this person is a member of. And we're in first century now. The early church is just beginning to get started. It's vital that the early church have a good reputation and take care of all the dissension between one another. I read a book a while back that is called Unchristian by David Kinnaman from the Barber Research Group. And in that study, in that book, he listed several things of why he calls them outsiders. Unchurched people are outsiders, why they don't want to come into church. And he says because the church is... Number one reason is because they're too judgmental. Church people are too judgmental and too hypocritical. You know, the reputation of a church can make or break a church. And we're not thinking of the church as us. We're thinking about the church as a mission station for bringing salvation for Jesus Christ throughout the world. And so it's important that these mission stations, the church, the body of Christ in the here and now, can do the mission that Jesus has called them to do. Kinnaman goes on to say, he says, having spent some time around sinners and around purported saints, I have a hunch why Jesus spent so much time around sinners. I think he preferred their company. Because the sinners were honest about themselves and had no pretense, and Jesus could deal with them. In contrast, the saints put on airs, judged him, and sought to catch him in a moral trap. In the end, it was the saints, not the sinners, who arrested Jesus. So, if the offender, in verse 17, if the offender still refuses to listen to even the church, then the scripture says that person is to be treated as a Gentile and a tax collector, which are words that represent a non-believer or an outsider, to use David Kinnaman's words or his terms. And there are some traditions that practice excommunication within the church for certain offenses. That does go on. And I suppose in our book of discipline, if you dig deep enough, you can find a church law in there that would recognize that for certain offenses. But I believe that in our text this morning, I believe that to be treated as a Gentile or a tax collector or a non-believer, an outsider, if you will, is to treat it as someone who doesn't have the faith, if you will, to be a church leader. They're just not there yet. Their faith is not strong enough to be a church leader. So you remove them from being in their church leadership position, where they can grow in their faith from the church leaders. That's the way I look. I can't see excommunicating anyone unless it's a grave offense, such as a threat to another member or a child or something, or destructive to the church, the body of Christ, and Christ's mission to the world. So be treated as a Gentile, but be a non-believer. Treat them as a non-believer. What we do for non-believers, we have hamburger feeds for them, and we do everything that we can do to bring them in so they can learn about Jesus and Jesus' love and the mission of the church. That's what we do for unbelievers. James 3:1 says, my brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers. And we can put church leaders in there. Because we know that we teachers will be judged more strictly. We have a higher standard of the way we are to act as church leaders, as Christians in the world. So we won't get that bad rating that Kinnaman found that he put in his book, Unchristian, too judgmental, too hypocritical. All right, verse 18. Binding and loosing. Binding and loosing have to do with forbidden and permitted activities. The church has the authority to make and uphold the laws of the church. We have all kinds of a law structure. We have a judicial council, if you will, who take care of church grievances. We have a process to go through. Binding and loosing is the church has the authority to make these laws and to carry out these laws and to follow through with these laws. You know, who is a candidate for ministry? Who for membership? For leadership? Remember our purpose here, the body of Christ. You know, the body of Christ and Christ's mission in the world is our whole mission. And so there's got to be guidelines here. Remember, it was Jesus who said in Matthew 5:30, if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for the whole body to go to hell. So it is with the membership of the church, the body of Christ. We must remember that the whole purpose of this scripture is is a togetherness and wholeness in the community of faith, the church family, the body of Christ. And mission, you know, in Matthew 28:19, the mission of the church to go forth and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's the whole purpose. So everything that we do in our church meetings and our mission projects, that's our goal. That's what we should have in our hearts and our minds. Are we making disciples for Jesus Christ, for the transformation of the world? Verse 20, Jesus says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." You know, Jesus reminds us, even in the midst of conflict, even in the midst of church conflict, we can accomplish tremendous things, a tremendous amount of good when we acknowledge that Christ walks through this with us, even through the conflict. And when we agree together in prayer about anything, Jesus says that my Father in heaven will do it. Remember the context, the body of Christ, the church, the mission of the church. So as the body of Christ praying together and in Christian love with one another and in unity with one another and working together for God's glory, God's kingdom, come on earth as it is in heaven, is the whole mission of Jesus' words here in this church discipline. So my question for you today is what about us? What about us? Are we here today for our own purpose, or are we here for the purpose of Christ? To build our faith, that we might reach others to the mission of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your words. Thank you, Matthew and his gospel, and the way he sandwiches a difficult text